Let's commence this session, which is the launch of the book In Another Country by Mr. Rafique Kathwari. The moderator for this session is Salman Tarik Kureshi. Mr. Salman Tarik Kureshi is an English language poet and newspaper columnist. His poems and short stories have appeared in various international and local periodicals. An anthology of his poems, Landscape of Mind, was one of the titles in Oxford University Press Jubilee series on Pakistan's 50th anniversary. As a newspaper feature writer, he has been writing regularly on socio-political issues and the evolution of the state in Pakistan. He has been a career business executive and management consultant. He is also an editorial consultant at Oxford University Press Pakistan. His wife is an artist and a teacher of fine arts. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum ji, we can thank you for the introduction. I'm here to launch this book. I'll hold up the book and then just talk about the author for a minute. It's called In Another Country. It's a book of poems by Rafique Kathwari, who is sitting here next to me, and whom we'll talk to in a minute, and then he will recite some of the poems in this book. Rafiq calls himself an Indian-American poet.
Kashmiri-American.
That's just where I was going to correct it, because I'm not quite sure which country Kashmir belongs to. I wouldn't like to bet on that one.
That's part of being in another country.
But it's another country. Anyhow. Rafiq was born in Srinagar, and Rafiq was born in Srinagar, and he migrated with his family, I think initially to Pakistan, perhaps at some point, and then to America. He has been educated in New York, has been to Columbia, and lived in New York for a long time, and now lives in Ireland, or till recently was living in Ireland, in County Ballinunan, or the town of Ballinunan in County Louth. He commutes, as he says, between Ireland, New York, and Delhi, right?
That's right.
That's quite an extensive commute. However, he is the recipient of the Kavanagh Award for this book, and he's been writing poetry most of his life. He tells me that his major influences are the Romantic poets, of course, and he is very much a landscape poet of the scene, but amongst other subjects which we'll talk about in a minute. He says that apart from the Romantics, his favorite poets include T.S. Eliot, who happens to be my favorite poet also, and Allen Ginsberg, another personal favorite of mine. However, moving on, he is also a photographer and has exhibited his photographs. Do you want to say anything more in the introduction, Rafiq, or would you like me to... he's been married is a couple of times, I believe.
Me?
Yes.
Married?
Yes.
No.
Never?
Just once.
Okay. Sorry.
That was enough.
But it's not at the moment encumbered. And having said that, oh yes, he's one of six children of his parents. Rafiq's mother is alive, and we're going to talk about her in a minute, because she's the subject of a number of his poems. Rafiq's mother suffered the misfortune of mental illness, specifically schizophrenia. And a number of the poems in this book do refer to his mother's condition. Therefore, I mention it. Otherwise, one would not be so indelicate as to do that. And we will talk about that in a minute. And this is where I'd like to come to Rafiq. Rafiq, would you like to tell us something about your own, it's Srinagar, it's New York, it's Ireland, and it's Delhi, and a lot else in between. Would you like to talk about that a bit, and then tell us something about your poems?
I'd like to talk about a lot of things, but first of all, thank you so much for being here. I was expecting five people to show up. That's what happens at poetry readings. So this is beyond my expectations. And since I am the first one inaugurating a book launch in room 007, I want to leave good vibes for what is to follow, the good, the bad, and the good, the better, and the best. We're part of a visual culture. We see a movie, good, bad, ugly, and that becomes part of our lingo. I was born in Srinagar, as Salman said, and I went to the United States when I was 22 years old, which wasn't too long ago. And I worked and I studied in the United States for the next 40 years. And then my marriage took me to Ireland, where I had time enough and fulfilled the requirements for submitting poems to so many contests in Ireland. And what happened next was that I won the Patrick Kavanagh Poetry Award. Let me just talk about the Patrick Kavanagh Poetry Award, usually not given to a non-Irish person, poet, but the adjudicator later on told me that the subject matter was compelling enough to overlook that, and this is part of the new Ireland, the new multicultural Ireland, and not a homogeneous Ireland. So that was pretty good anyway. And that is why you are here. What sets this book apart a bit from the other great poetry books is that it confronts head-on a taboo in most cultures about schizophrenia, with which my mother, as Salman pointed out, was inflicted when I was a kid, a lad growing up in Kashmir. So about two-thirds of the book is about schizophrenia as a subject, which isn't easy to do in poetry. And the other one-third of the book deals with my own coming of age. There are other things I'm involved in. One is that I have translated from the original Urdu selected poems of Iqbal while I was studying at Columbia. That happened as an accident and became a wonderful, challenging project. And that's already set to go. I'm just looking for somebody to show a little bit of mercy. The third project, in addition to the poems that I keep writing, is my father's journal. I was talking to Salman about them over lunch. He wrote journals from the day he entered Aligarh University in 1930s. He wrote journals. From 1934 to 1998 when he died. So that's a mountain of material, 365 multiplied by 60-something. So I am slowly publishing pages from those journals, one man's historical, one man's point of view of what happened when India divided herself. Some of these journal entries are very compelling. Sherry Rehman, who's a friend, said, do whatever is necessary to bring this out. So there are these two or three literary projects that I'm looking at, and I have to work fast because when you are in your mid-60s, time seems to go faster. Having said that, let me begin by recite, what's on the agenda is four poems, short ones, given the constraints of time limits over here, and I'll try to make it worth your while being here. The first poem was a challenge to see how much emotion can you compress in one line. The title of the poem, the title of the poem is Upon Receiving Father at JFK After His Long Flight from Kashmir. Let me give it to you again. Upon receiving father at JFK after his long flight from Kashmir. As I fling my arms wide, he extends his hand. The title of my next poem was triggered, and I think triggered is the right word for it, by a caption in the local broadsheet we have in New York. Israeli patrols kill 90 dogs in Arab town. The New York Times, 14th April, 1995. Mother, I'm living in sin with an Egyptian Jew raised in Paris. We stroll in Central Park, her mat golua off the leash. Lucky he is not in Hebron, where gods kill dogs for sport. Apparently the reason the Israeli patrols shot the dogs was because the barking of the dogs used to alert the Palestinian kids in the nearby village, so they could escape, hide, so that when they killed the dogs, that wasn't possible at all. The next poem on the agenda is really a tribute to Patrick Kavanagh. Patrick Kavanagh is as important a poet in Ireland as Yeats is. Yeats was an elitist. Yeats' father's paintings are hung in the National Gallery in Dublin. While Kavanagh was a man of the soil, lived in rural Ireland, he was mostly a self-taught poet. But he died in 1972, I think, and he left a very strong body of work. In fact, the Nobel laureate Seamus Heaney has said that he was deeply influenced by Kavanagh. So I urge you, if you find selected poems of Patrick Kavanagh and a picture of him on the cover, go get it and you'll see what I mean. He was very democratic, not elitist. In many ways he has, even though he grew up in the rural Ireland, he had a European vision for Ireland. He was way, 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 way ahead of his time. So this tribute to him is adapted from a short story by Nasruddin. Nasruddin wrote political satire and is believed to have lived in the 14th century in what is today Turkey. His stories are short but loaded with a punch. I think we need political satire here more than any time. Veracity. "May I borrow your donkey?" A neighbor asked Kavanaugh, who said, "I'm so sorry I loaned out my donkey yesterday." At which point the donkey brayed in the barn, and the neighbor, believing the donkey made Kavanaugh a liar, asked, "So what is that I hear?" To which Kavanaugh said, "Friend, are you going to believe me or a donkey?" Give me a moment. We're doing very well on time there. Yeah? Because I don't want to take the other person's time. You come all the way from New York and they give you 15 minutes of fame.
Well, that's all that that's all that the artist allowed you.
And exactly, and it's getting shorter and shorter and shorter because we live in the age of the internet. And my friend Siri at Columbia University said the most invaluable commodity in the age of the internet is attention. Nobody has any attention. It's like this all the time. Anyway, I'm on the last poem, for which I'll have to actually sit down, and it's called Hallucinations, and for that I need a help of an audience. Don't worry, you'll come back down for a minute. This is these are words, these are lines that, can you hear me? Is it okay? Yeah? These are lines that my mother said to me when I flew from New York to Kashmir to fly her to the United States after my father died, because we felt it inappropriate to have her stay with my father's second wife under the same roof in the ancestral house, which my father had gifted to the new wife. And the whole notion of two wives living under the same roof is alien to many Western cultures, unless you happen to be living in Utah. But in South Asia, in the Middle East, it happens even in liberal, progressive Kashmiri families such as mine. So I'll try to see what I can do here. Not happening. Yeah, that's better. Trying to see if I can replicate the way she wears her thing like that. That'll do. It's hallucinations, it's in her own voice. "The servants never listen to me. Only when the new wife nods do they run around like rats to fetch the thermos. There's poison in the spring water. Chanel, a present from my son, Farouk, in America. The wind carried my message after all. There are thieves under my bed.
I want latches on the door and a new mirror. The last one shattered when the nail gave way. I hang my shawl on the wall, dried roses upside down. My room not swept for 6 days. No water to soak clothes. My daughter will clean when she visits. The door is bolted from the outside. If the house catches fire, who will open it? Will I burn alive? The servant's outhouse. It turns my stomach. The pain is broken. I'm going to spray some Chanel to make this room better smelling. My grandson, from his grave, come to visit. He's with his great-grandfather. They both received transfusions. My husband says I don't need a doctor, but that doesn't keep the new wife from going to the general hospital. I am still the head of this home. I am still the head of this home. Oh, wind, tell my son in America, the dollars he sends, the new wife misspends. Tell him I need a car to buy roses at Shalimar. My husband has lost interest in roses. For years he's been saying, Mariam is mad, mad. Is there anything the matter with me? My sky is vaster than my mind. My son builds homes for me in America, views of river and rolling hills where the Maharaja of Kashmir exhales. I have no water, no water. The servant washing dishes keeps it from reaching me. Everyone has cancer. It's no big deal. Even the midwives have cancer. Oh, wind, what is keeping my grandson so long? Oh, look. Dead mosquitoes in my denture bowl. Thank you very much. Well, we still have time for some questions.
Yes, that's disturbing. That was very disturbing. That was very disturbing, and I'm not going to. Any questions from anybody? Please, let's, the poet is here, the book is here. Any questions from anyone? Back there. Mike.
Maneeza Naqvi, hello, how are you?
How are you?
thank you for being here.
My pleasure. My father and I are here, and I just wanted to say that that really took me by surprise, and that was pure genius. This last poem that you read, really, I must say that it was very moving and very powerful, Rafique.
Maniza, there's more of it in the book. And there are about, as I said, two-thirds of the book is about my mother's voice. She was here in Pakistan in the 1950s, and one of the things she did was she wrote letters to the prime ministers, the ambassadors, about all sorts of things, but mostly about Kashmir, and she got responses. So there are about 10 or 12 epistolary poems you might like, but you don't. Thank you.
We have another question there, just in front of Maniza Naqvi. Right, the mic over there.
Where? Right there? Right here, right here.
Yeah. Where's the mic?
Right here, this no? gentleman, right here.
Okay, no.
Was it yourself?
No?
I guess not.
Anyone else?
Anyone else? Because I think we're in our last, we can. I think
we have 5 minutes. You know how much time 5 minutes is? Huge.
Why don't you read us another poem?
Read you another poem? I'd be delighted to. Other people have
okay.
to hear it too.
All right.
Go on.
Given your, you know, this kind of a global or transnational exposure and your identity, if I would say, again, this sense of belongingness there in Kashmir is very strong. How would you comment on that? I mean, especially it was very, very evident from the last poem that you have read, the hallucination based on your mother's hallucinations. So how would you comment on that? How do you perceive this concept of belongingness? Where do you belong, actually? Or you belong nowhere at all? Or you belong everywhere?
I think that somebody made a reference to that this afternoon, that you could be the whole point of in another country is not just a geographic point, it is a mental, intellectual point also. Where do I belong? I am first myself, I'm first a Kashmiri, then an American citizen, I'm also a resident of Ireland, and I'm also a overseas citizen of India by compulsion, because if you've ever been through the visa regimes between these two countries, you will understand what that. So I, in many ways, I'm lucky because there are hundreds of millions of Syrian refugees who have a roof over their head. There's a question from somewhere here, right here.
Sir, what about your attachment with Pakistan?
Excuse me?
Your attachment with Pakistan?
My attachment with Pakistan is that
you were born in Kashmir, which is most likely the part of Kashmir which is currently in India.
Kashmir Valley, yes.
Okay. Then you went to America, you have...
The first 10 years of my life were spent in Pakistan. My family was one of the millions of families who were refugees. So that's one attachment, and my parental attachments here. My mother and father, our schooling was here, and my father was not allowed to go back to Kashmir, so he joined the government here, and he was a diplomat and all that kind of stuff, and my mother first experienced these voices here in Pakistan during the regime of General Ayub, when the wonder treatment that was available was ECT. So there is a very solid connection with Pakistan. And even if I didn't have any connection with Pakistan, we have poems, we are talking, poems are universal, and states are very afraid of poets anyway.
I think our time is up, and the subsequent inhabitants of this hall, but some of the others will stay here, impatient to come up and take these seats. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Thank you, Rafique.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Buy the book. Please encourage.
It's available at Liberty Books out there at a huge discount. And I'll be glad to sign it for you. And those of you who buy it, I'll even spray it with the most classic champagne. Not five, it's Mademoiselle, the first one. All right?
Thank you.
Thank you so much.